Cantaloupe Island has an infectious groove that is a great contrast to the more demanding pieces on Herbie Hancock's Empyrean Isles. It's a well-known tune that we as bass players need to be familiar with. So let's take a closer look at this approachable and essential bass line. Welcome to Learn Jazz Bass with Matt Rabicki. If you're interested in hearing more about how to play jazz bass, please subscribe to my channel. Be sure to like this video too if you would, and check below for a link to a free PDF related to today's discussion. Now this record, Empyrean Isles, is a tour de force. We've got Herbie on piano, the master Ron Carter on bass, Tony Williams on drums, another incomparable musician, and the great Freddie Hubbard on trumpet. As I said, this tune is very well known, and it's also not too hard to play. So let's take a closer look at it right now. So like the tune All Blues, Cantaloupe Island is a great opportunity to strengthen and practice your ability to memorize a piece. There's not a whole lot going on here, so I highly recommend that you memorize it. It's more than likely going to be called at some jam session you're at somewhere. So let's take a look at each part section by section, and that also helps with the memorization. The very first part, let's break down the notes one by one. Here we've got F natural. This would be the first fret on the E string for electric. Then we're going C natural, E flat, F again, the octave, back down to F. That's it. This can be quite a hand workout for your left hand, just kind of like All Blues was, especially because it repeats during the whole song. So that's the first section. F, C, E flat, F, F, C, E flat, F. And to count it, one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. Now, the next section gives us an opportunity to practice our shifting. We've got to come from here to here with our first finger on the D flat. So when I think about this kind of shift, I am of course using the experience I have from playing, but I still use sort of a signpost or an anchor point of where this C is, because I just need to go a half step in terms of space. I just need to go from C to D flat. So I know where my pinky is. I sort of visualize it. I can even look and see. And then I'm going to shift so that my first finger goes right next to it. So I'm thinking of the C here, I'm shifting my whole hand, and my first finger is now right next to it. I don't have a problem if you want to use a tuner, for example, to make sure that you've got the right notes at the beginning of your playing. I feel like you will not need it in time, and I'm all about trying to keep you on the bass and headed towards success, whatever that takes. To that end, I also don't have a problem whatsoever with you marking up your bass in some way that indicates where some of the notes are. It can be a temporary thing or a semi-temporary thing. Eventually, you also won't need it. I'm not sure why we don't all use it all the time, but you can see even here on my bass here, this Upton bass I have, I've put temporary stickers on the side for my students so that they know where the notes are on this particular bass because of note. Of course, notes are different from bass to bass, sort of locations, right? And it really can help in sort of situations where you're recording or this is a very high pressure situation where I absolutely must play in tune. This is gonna help. So going back to the line, we have made this shift to D flat. We're going from F, C, E flat, F. We're shifting to D flat with our first finger. This is the fourth fret on electric bass. D flat, A flat on the D string, C flat on the G string, D flat on the G string. D flat, A flat, C flat, D flat, D flat, A flat. Same rhythm as before. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. The next section gives us an opportunity to practice our double stops. If you're not familiar with what a double stop is, this is playing two notes at the same time. The two notes we're playing here are D natural and A natural. There's a couple ways to finger this, and I'm not 100% sure, maybe one of you know for sure, about where Mr. Carter did play this on the bass. My instinct, based on context and sort of knowing generally how Mr. Carter plays, is that he would have played them closed right here, D natural and A natural, because he's coming from right there with the D flat, so moving your hand there makes sense. Additionally, it's harder to shift to the other way of playing, which would be up here, either with your first or second finger, but open D and A there. So coming from there, another big shift that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It makes more sense to move your hand just up a little bit. Now to finger this double stop together, I'm essentially just quickly raking my fingers over both strings. I can use one finger or two. Sometimes this gives me a sense of getting a louder sound. Using two fingers gives me a sense of getting a louder sound, is what I'm saying, in case the bass playing is too loud. You could also theoretically put one finger on each string and sort of pull out. The thing is, it's really hard to get a lot of volume with that, although it is a pretty sound. So it's really up to you how you choose to do it. After we play these double stops, D and A together, and by the way, this would be the fifth fret on electric and the seventh fret on electric. Seventh fret on the D string, fifth fret on the A string. After this D and A together, we go back to this original bass ostinato over the F minor seven. Now, there's not a lot more to the song, but whenever that happens, that's a great opportunity for you to spend some of your energy paying attention to other musical things that are happening. How is the bass locking up with the piano? How is it locking up with the drums? And how are all three locking up? And so on and so forth. Gives you more chance to listen to sort of the general vibe, what's everyone else doing and intending and so on. Also notice things like how the tempo speeds up a little bit over time on this particular recording. You can also just listen for the length of the notes of what Mr. Carter is doing. And I think that's an important thing to pay attention to when you want to play this line. The reason is because the phrasing of it, the rhythmic phrasing of it, is slightly imperfect in a really important and good way. So we've got this first note, the F, which is this grounding sort of, I'm establishing, I'm right at the downbeat. And then the C is anticipated, or syncopation, the end of two. So that sort of moves us forward. The thing is, both those notes are held quite long. The E flat and F, they're not short notes, but where they occur relative to sort of the bar line is a little bit compressed, just ever so slightly compressed. You see what I mean? It's not quite perfectly metronomically in time. And that's good. It gives us that sense of push and pull of sort of moving forward, coming back, and so on. It's not something I don't think you necessarily even have to practice, but rather just turn your mind towards trying to imitate what Mr. Carter is doing, and you'll get the idea. Just think about trying to get that sound, and you'll get the idea. The same thing occurs on the D-flat 7 as well. Those first two notes are quite long, as well as the double stops are obviously very long too. And there it is, Cantaloupe Island. It's very accessible, very approachable, definitely worth playing with friends. And as a bass player, this is something that is essential for us to know. So now hopefully you feel confident in playing this essential bass line. One thing to note in the overall approach of Cantaloupe Island is the general rhythmic feel. It exists in this funny place between a straight feel and a swing feel. There's no explicit quarter notes, walking bass line, and so on. But what all the musicians play is deeply influenced by a very rooted sense of not only the swing rhythm, but rhythms of all kinds. These are master musicians, after all. If we're comparing straight and swing rhythms, straight rhythms are evenly distributed, sort of, in time. But swing rhythms are not even. In fact, they're a little offset from one another. If you are a visual learner, you might think of straight rhythms as being sort of boxy, and swing rhythms as perhaps being more rounded or oval. If I were to make up my own notation for straight and swing rhythm, the swing rhythms would look like maybe boxes as note heads, and swing rhythms would use the conventional oval shape. I mean, think about it. That oval is sort of leaning forward, isn't it? And it's not evenly distributed up and down either. It sort of pushes in one direction. And that's kind of the feeling we want to get with the swing feeling. So if it were up to me, I might have the note heads be different depending on the rhythmic feel. I'm not sure how practical that would be, and a lot of people might get mad at me, but it's just a thought to help visualize straight versus swing. Another rhythmic aspect to pay attention to is how the bass and piano work together. The juxtaposition of the two really helped to make this feel what it is. The grounded aspect of the bass is really helped by the lift of the syncopated piano. So think about that as you listen. Lastly, as I mentioned before, the quality of how the rhythm of the bass line is played, and it's also played by Herbie in his left hand as well, that rhythmic quality is really important to the general rhythmic vibe of the piece. So remember, it's got this sort of loping quality to it that sort of pushes and pulls. It's not quite really specifically metronomically, digitally in time, which is a good thing. So thank you for watching. Once again, please subscribe and like this video if you would. Check for that link below for the free PDF. And always remember, straight ahead and strive for tone.